We move our meet the candidate sessions over to District 97 now. Our first candidate up tonight is Clifford Stockton III. Clifford, thank you for welcoming us tonight. You get no extra points for the fact that people mistake my first name for yours almost constantly. Cliff or Clifford is almost the most common thing I am called other than my first name. So I wish I could give you extra points for that, but can't do that this evening. And if you've ever been called Clint, I apologize.
Clint, Clifton, many variations. So I can share your frustration.
Yes, yes. Maybe after COVID, we'll share in that misery one day. Well, again, thank you for joining us tonight. We're going to jump straight into the questions and hopefully have some time at the end either to take questions from attendees who can do that through the Q&A feature in Zoom. And then, of course, we'll allow some time for you to say any additional words at the end.
Perfect.
First question tonight is Governor Lee recently issued Executive Order Number 15. Among the provisions in that order include the ability for nurse practitioners to practice with autonomy. What is your position on the expansion of scope of practice for non-physician providers such as nurse practitioners and physician assistants?
I think that's a great question. So thank you for that question, Clint. I want to start off by saying that my wife is a registered nurse, has been for the last 6 years. And my grandmother serves currently on the Memphis Health Center's board as their president. And so I work really closely with frontline workers as it relates to that volunteerism with the Memphis Health Center, as well as having a wife who has been on the front lines before, specifically in the NICU. And she, you know, really has a great amount of feeling about this because we understand with the lack of healthcare and the closings that have happened in rural areas and the lack of access that there are scenarios where there is only a nurse practitioner or an advanced nurse available and there needs to be a call made. But we also are very aware that there is value in not just the training and experience, but the practice that those medical doctors and physicians have. And they need to supervise and manage the relationship with the other healthcare professionals to be able to lead effective practice and to be able to lead effective healthcare. And so we are against the governor's executive order that allows for the increase in scope and autonomy for those workroom professionals. We do know that there is a place for leadership for those folks and that they are on the front lines working really hard. You know, I have four little ones and our pediatrician's office has advanced nurse practitioners that when there is an emergency or a need for a last minute visit, we do, you know, visit with those professionals, but we also require ask for the opinion of our healthcare professional that is the medical principal. I'm again, and I believe that in order to run successful practices and in order to provide a high quality healthcare, there needs to be that hierarchy and that training and experience and practices is invaluable.
Great, thank you. We're going to move into the next question. So there's a lot of difficult decisions being made today that force business owners, parents, policymakers, and lots of people to have to balance your personal physical health and maybe the health of an entire community with economic health in order to get back to business. We hear that phrase quite often. Can you talk about what your thought process would be if you're faced with similar challenges? How do you prioritize, you know, the health of a population versus the, you know, that dire need to get the economy back up and going?
Well, first of all, I want to thank you for that question and thank Representative Cooper before me for her response and her service because similar to her, I believe that we need to use data and the express opinion guided by that data from our healthcare professionals. We need to be listening to our Shelby County Health Department and our federal CDC in terms of their guidelines. And I'm an educator. So I started off in the classroom and it's really impacting my colleagues I'm no longer in the classroom. I've been working towards focusing on increasing education and instructional coaching practices for those educators and those principals and those leaders. But I was in a school building when the superintendent sent the note to close schools. And I know for a fact that those educators were really fearing not just for the safety of their students, but fearing for their own personal safety and the safety of their family members. And so I know for a fact we have to use data to inform us on how we make these decisions. And I really enjoyed the fact that our city council in Memphis was able to pass the mask ordinance and mandate social distancing. And I understand from a business perspective how limiting that can be. But I do know that revenues and our economy can be respurred through policies, investment, and sound practices, but we cannot revive or bring back the lives of those who have been lost due to COVID-19 or other pre-existing conditions. You know, that being that our healthcare system is overwhelmed, have been not being paid as keen attention to because of COVID-19 and just the capacity of our healthcare system. So I'm focused on making sure that when we make decisions, not just policy decisions, but when we make common sense practical decisions, they're being driven by the data and by informing us our experiences on those situations.
Okay, great. Moving into the next question. So it's inevitable, we're already seeing it, that our state and our communities are going to be faced with those economic challenges that we mentioned. You know, tax revenue is going to decrease and probably some other sources of revenue as well due to the pandemic. So, you know, lawmakers are going to have to start talking about cuts. So how do you prioritize cuts? And if you were to cut healthcare spending, how would you do that? Can you walk us through that?
I think when we're talking about the revenue loss based on COVID and the impact of COVID-19, we have to look at what is our rainy day fund in the state of Tennessee. The money, the billions of dollars that we have to be able to use for this very scenario. And I believe for a fact that we need to focus on not cutting healthcare investments, but increasing healthcare investments. 666,000 people without healthcare, and so many more people without access to TennCare. Care. We need to expand Medicaid in the state of Tennessee, and it's a priority that needs to happen immediately. I think that we also have to understand that although cuts do need to be made, we need to be making cuts on more longitudinal investments and focusing in on how to serve and provide resources to people who need them right now. No one should be fearful of getting a COVID test. No one should be fearful of getting a well visit. No one should be fearful of being able to visit in a safe way with their healthcare professional. And everyone should have that ability to do that. So I believe we need to actually invest more money in what we're spending in healthcare and as a state. And so when it comes to cuts, we do need to be focusing in on cuts that aren't going to impact the people of Tennessee.
Okay, great. So with the remaining amount of time, whether you want to expand on any other healthcare issues or if you want to touch things that don't involve healthcare, I want to give you a couple minutes to say some general words or talk about some other issues.
Absolutely. I just want to take a few minutes to thank you for the opportunity and thank the association for the opportunity to be here in this format and share just a little bit more about my approach and more about the campaign. And I just want to just say that just generally and quickly, the things that we're focused on in our campaign are things that we are being told from the constituents when we either canvass via phone virtually or at virtual events or socially distanced in interactions with individuals. They're focused on, number one, our economy. They're focused on the jobs and the furloughs, and they're focused on how they're going to be able to pay their bills on a day-to-day basis. And I believe that the foundation to that growth is our healthcare system. And so we are focused on expanding Medicaid in the state of Tennessee and working across the aisle to get that accomplished if we achieve the party's nomination. And we're also lastly focused on really making sure that our public safety system is the strongest it can be, not just our criminal justice system, but our public health system as well. I believe COVID has exposed some of the ways in which we could be or could have been more prepared and where we could have made more investments. And so we're focused on continuing on listening to the constituents of District 97, having those conversations on a day-to-day basis, means you're relaying those conversations and those interests into policies that are going to impact Tennesseans in a positive way. So that's my little bit. If anyone wants to learn more, cliffordstockton.com is our website. And I am always reachable. All of our contact information is on that website.
All right, that sounds great. Clifford, thanks so much for joining us tonight, and good luck to you with your campaign efforts, and stay safe and healthy out there. Up next at 6:15, we're gonna have Ruby Powell Dennis. So we'll have a really short break here, and we will interview Ruby shortly.
Thank you for the time.
Thank you, Clifford.